More news now. The Metro Manila Development Authority optimistic the National Capital Region will be able to vaccinate more than the majority of its population by the end of September. MMDA Chairman Benjer Abalos estimates Metro Manila could hit 14.5 million vaccine doses by then. And he points out Metro Manila is now able to inoculate an average of 170,000 individuals per day. Abalos says the NCR will help provinces with their vaccine rollouts once the region has achieved its immunization targets.
Napag-usapan nga namin kung matatapos ang Metro Manila, ang mga manpower naman ng Metro Manila ay makikiisa naman sa mga kabayan natin sa mga probinsya. It goes without saying, of course, that hindi naman tayo nawawala ng focus dito na yung mga sobrang tulong natin, kung merong konti, ibalik na lang sa Metro para matapos na rin po tayo ito, no? So we're just on course. Habang tumutulong tayo sa kapatid natin sa probinsya, nagbabakunan naman tayo rito.
So far, 3.2 million NCR residents have received their first dose, while over a million are fully vaccinated. The health department says the Philippines is now considered a low-risk area for COVID-19, but there are some areas that remain high risk. Let's get the details now from Katrina Domingo. Katrina now joins us on the line. Kat, go ahead.
Hi, Carmina. That's right. According to DOH Epidemiology Bureau Director Alethea de Guzman, in the past 2 weeks, the growth rate of the virus nationwide has been at -9%, putting the Philippines now at a low-risk category for COVID-19. This is because the average daily attack rate from June 13 to 26 was only at 5.42%. That means in a span of 2 weeks, not more than 5 people are infected by the virus on a daily basis. Now, areas within the National Capital Region, once the epicenter of COVID-19 in the country, are the ones showing the lowest cases according to data from the DOH. The areas outside NCR are taking up the largest portion of new cases, with Laguna, Davao Region, Western Visayas, Sogsiligan, and Eastern Visayas identified as the only regions that are still considered as high-risk areas. Now, the growth rate of new cases in the National Capital Region was at -26% in the past 2 weeks, while healthcare utilization and intensive care unit utilization in the region was at 37.73% and 41.66% respectively. This means, Carmina, that hospitals in Metro Manila are not full and are capable of catering to more COVID-19 patients should there be an influx or a resurgence of new cases in the coming weeks. Now, the DOH is investigating why Laguna is the lone NCR plus area that failed to reduce the virus's transmission in the last 2 weeks. But officials initially reported that there were incidents wherein there were less adherence with minimum public health standards, meaning that they saw gatherings and social events and the tendency to hold meetings indoors. Several areas far from Metro Manila, meanwhile, remain at high risk due to their high utilization of their hospitals and intensive care units. For example, ICU units in Davao and Western Visayas are both at 81% full, according again to data from the DOH, while Sogsiligan's intensive care utilization rate is at 66.67%, while Eastern Visayas's is at 63.44%. So still quite high numbers there, Carmina. According to the DOH, while the COVID situation in most parts of the Philippines is improving, the country cannot afford to be complacent as another spike in new cases may occur due to the foreign variants of the virus. Of June 30, 1.4 million Filipinos have been infected with COVID-19, and of these people, 24,000 died, 1.3 million recovered, while about 48,000 other patients are still battling the disease. Carmina.
Yeah, Kat, tell me something, though. Did they base this new classification just on the numbers today? Shouldn't it have been like an accumulation of numbers, let's say, in the past month or so for it to us really be considered low risk? Because that has to be sustained. It shouldn't just reflect the current numbers because you know how the numbers fluctuate at any given day. Go ahead, Kat.
Carmina, most of the numbers that the DOH usually releases to the media are based on a two-week or a month-long assessment. Let's see, for example, I'm looking at the chart right now that was provided by the DOH. In the past 2 weeks, the average daily attack rate in the entire country is at 5.42, meaning only up to 5 people a day contract the disease. Now, if we compare that to the period from May 30 to July 12, that means the previous 3 to 4 weeks, the Philippines' average daily attack rate is still at 5.96. It means that not more than 6 people contract COVID-19 daily since May 30. That's according, again, to data from the DOH. Now, a while ago, reporters asked the DOH if there are low cases recorded, primarily because the testing rate in the country has also dropped, primarily because some people are now using antigen tests instead of RT-PCR tests. But the DOH says that may not be a contributory factor in their in the data that they are presenting to us now. Carmina.
Right. And what's their reason for coming out with this classification? Is it also to sort of give a better view of the Philippines to the outside world in the hopes of helping the economy reopen, and also in the hopes of improving the image of the Philippines and its COVID response to the rest of the world, Kat?
That's right, Carmina. This gives the Philippines an advantage compared to other countries, because if we would look at the situation, at least in the Southeast Asian region, let's put the focus on the Delta variant and how it has sort of spread in other neighboring countries. But in the Philippines, the number of Delta variant cases has remained below, I guess, 20 patients. The last time I checked, there were only 17 Delta variant carriers in the country. And the DOH has been highlighting this in press conferences to not only impress investors, but to also somehow appease Filipinos that the situation is under control as of this moment. Carmina.
Will it necessarily mean that you're going to open up the borders? Because that may just be the vessel, the vehicle for the Delta variant to really find its way to our shores, Kat. Because that's a tough balancing act.
Exactly, Carmina. The DOH has been saying that even though we are seeing several gains on the health front of the pandemic in the country, the situation in the Philippines remains fragile. They call it fragile because the DOH tells us that even if we are already seeing gains in our battle against COVID-19, with just one super spreader event in one province, or particularly in Metro Manila, then we can go back to the situation we were in March, wherein the government had to impose stricter community quarantine guidelines that would further choke the economy and would invalidate the gains that we had in the previous month. So definitely, Carmina, so far, no word yet on when border restrictions would be eased, but that is not the priority of the DOH as of the moment. Their priority right now is to maintain, if not improve, status quo, which is to further lower the cases of COVID-19 in the country.
All right. Carmina. Thanks a lot. Katrina Domingo there joining us on the line. Continue to keep safe, Kat. Take care.